Hello, this is Dr. Lauren Pena from Cincinnati Children's Hospital in Cincinnati. Welcome to this infographic-based educational activity on Pompe disease.
The following podcast is part of a certified educational activity titled Expert Insights on Available and Emerging Therapies for the Management of Pompe Disease. Access the entire activity and complete the post-test at www.peerview.com/DJF. Downloadable infographics and additional resources are also available.
Pompe disease is an autosomal recessive lysosomal storage disorder. It is also categorized as a glycogen storage disease, specifically glycogen storage disease type 2. Pompe disease is due to deficiency in the lysosomal enzyme acid alpha glucosidase, and this deficiency leads to intralysosomal accumulation of glycogen in all tissues, particularly in skeletal muscle. There are two types of Pompe disease. The earliest presentation is infantile onset Pompe disease, or IOPD. These patients are symptomatic in the first year of life, and death occurs soon afterwards if the disorder remains untreated. One distinguishing characteristic between infantile onset and late onset Pompe disease is that cardiomyopathy is a prominent finding in the infantile form. For late onset Pompe disease, the symptoms appear later in life after the first year, and patients might progress more slowly with wheelchair confinement in some and respiratory failure as well later in life. As I mentioned, the pathophysiology of Pompe disease is due to deficiency in acid alpha glucosidase, or GAA enzyme. And this is a lysosomal enzyme that is delivered to lysosomes via a mannose-6-phosphate receptor and a tag of mannose-6-phosphate in the enzyme. GAA gene is located on chromosome 17 in the long arm, and there are a number of mutations that have been described on the GAA gene. There are several common mutations that are found in different ethnic groups. Regarding symptoms for infantile onset Pompe disease, I mentioned that cardiomegaly and cardiomyopathy is a distinguishing characteristic. There's also left ventricular hypertrophy, and frequently on exam, this is picked up via a murmur. An important point to make is that the EKG findings in infantile onset Pompe disease are characteristic, and there is a short PR interval and tall QRS complexes. And it's an important finding that can increase the level of suspicion if present for the clinicians taking care of patients with infantile onset Pompe disease. These patients frequently have microglossia or a large tongue. They can have feeding difficulties, partially because of the microglossia and the obstruction, but also because of the muscle weakness that they experience. There is frequently hepatomegaly in the patients. There's respiratory distress, primarily because of the cardiac compromise. There's hypotonia and weakness, absent deep tendon reflexes, and because of this hypotonia and the cardiac disease, there is frequently failure to thrive. The symptoms in late-onset Pompe disease include proximal weakness, decreased deep tendon reflexes, a Gower sign, joint contractures. The patients can have difficulty chewing and swallowing. There might be respiratory insufficiency, external dyspnea, orthopnea, sleep apnea. Patients can have hyperlordosis and scoliosis, chronic pain, exercise intolerance, and some GI symptoms. There are presentations that can be unusual and can also be seen in late-onset Pompe disease. Frequently, these patients have been misdiagnosed as having polymyositis. They can have symptoms of limb girdle muscular dystrophy and also rigid spine syndrome. The differential diagnosis for each type of Pompe disease might be different. For infantile onset, type 1 SMA can be under differential because of the weakness. Glycogen storage diseases type 3 and 4 can be under differential, as well as primary muscular dystrophies and mitochondrial myopathies. For late-onset Pompe disease, I mentioned the limb girdle muscular dystrophies, along with Duchenne and Becker muscular dystrophy, rigid spine syndrome, myasthenia gravis, polymyositis, and some of the glycogen storage disorders, such as type 5 and 6. Ascertaining Pompe disease can be via different avenues. more recently, newborn screening has become available in some states. A single abnormal newborn screen result is not regarded as sufficient diagnosis for Pompe disease. That is an important statement to make. Clinicians can begin a diagnostic workup by sending enzyme activity measurement for GAA, and this can be performed on dried blood spots in some labs. Also, peripheral leukocytes, so whole blood or muscle samples, can be used for measurement of enzyme activity. Enzyme activity measurement is frequently followed by molecular testing of the GAA gene. So detection of two mutations in trans, so in the two different alleles for GAA, is necessary to make a molecular diagnosis of Pompe disease. Some of the supportive laboratory findings of Pompe disease can include an elevation in serum CK. It's important to note, though, that whereas high levels of CK can be seen in patients with infantile onset Pompe disease, this is a variable finding for late onset Pompe disease. And in fact, the serum CK might be normal or very mildly elevated in some patients with late onset Pompe disease. Urine analysis of the hexose-tetrasaccharide or HEX4 is a sensitive finding for infantile onset Pompe disease and can be another marker of clinical suspicion of Pompe disease. I should mention that the tetrasaccharide can be normal in patients with late onset Pompe disease. Following a diagnosis of Pompe disease, there are specific evaluations that are recommended to look at the extent of disease involvement and formulate an appropriate supervision plan for these patients. Some of the recommended evaluations include chest radiographs, EKG, echocardiogram, pulmonary function testing, an evaluation of nutrition and feeding, audiology, physical therapy, a sleep study, a disability inventory, and genetic counseling for recurrence risk. Some of the clinical manifestations of the disorder can include cardiomyopathy, and medical intervention for cardiomyopathy needs to be individualized because some of the standard drugs that are used can be counterindicated in certain stages of the disease process. There have also been some case reports of arteriopathies in these patients, and the treatment does not differ from the general population, at least at this point. Some patients can have conduction disturbances, and 24-hour Holter monitoring is useful to characterize the type and severity of the rhythm disturbance. And some of the management recommendations can include avoidance of stress, avoidance of infection, fever, dehydration, and careful planning for anesthesia. Medical therapy, if indicated for the conduction disturbances, should be undertaken by a cardiologist who's familiar with Pompe disease. In terms of weakness, physical therapy is important to maintain a normal range of motion and assist with ambulation. And particularly for younger patients, the proximal motor weakness can result in contractures of the pelvic girdle and limit mobility. So it's important to develop an aggressive management plan that could include surgery. Some of these patients can have difficulty with communication. Speech therapy is important to maintain independence in communication, as well as formulate a plan for augmentative communication devices if necessary. Because of some of the feeding problems in infants, sometimes specialized diets can be necessary to maintain maximal nutrition, including gastric feedings. And for adults or older individuals with late onset Pompe disease, feeding concerns can develop over time, and some of these can be managed with a soft diet or maybe even with gastric or jejunal feedings if necessary. Because of the respiratory insufficiency, CPAP and BiPAP may be required, and inspiratory and expiratory training has been shown in a limited number of patients to improve respiratory muscle strength in adults with late onset Pompe disease. In extreme cases, particularly in the infantile form, severe respiratory insufficiency could require tracheostomy and ventilation. There are several treatment modalities for Pompe disease utilizing enzyme replacement therapies, and some of them are approved and some are emerging, and I'll talk about those. Aglucosidase alpha is approved for treatment of infantile and late onset Pompe disease. It's a recombinant enzyme, and the recommended dosage is 20 milligrams per kilogram once every 2 weeks delivered via intravenous infusion. The approval was based on a 52-week study of aglucosidase alpha in infantile onset Pompe disease. There were 18 infants in the study, all diagnosed with infantile onset Pompe disease at 6 months or younger of age. They all had severe GAA deficiency and cardiomyopathy. And the randomization was for two doses, 20 milligrams per kilogram or 40 milligrams per kilogram every 2 weeks. There was data analysis after 52 weeks of treatment in the cohort, and all patients survived to 18 months of age. When compared with an untreated cohort, treatment with aglucosidase alpha reduced the risk of death by 99%, the risk of death or invasive ventilation by 92%, and the risk of death or any type of ventilation by 88%. When the two cohorts were compared, there was no clear advantage to treating with a higher dose with regards to efficacy. There was an extension study in that cohort, and 16 of the original 18 patients were enrolled for the extension study. They continued to receive aglucosidase alpha at either 20 milligrams per kilogram every 2 weeks or 40 milligrams per kilogram every 2 weeks for up to 3 years. And over the entire study period, treatment with aglucosidase alpha reduced the risk of death by 95%, the risk of invasive ventilation by 91%, and the risk of any type of ventilation or death by 87%. This is when compared to an untreated historical control group. In those who had cardiomyopathy, they continued to improve. 11 of the 16 patients learned and sustained substantial motor skills. And again, it was demonstrated that there was no significant difference in either safety or efficacy parameters between 20 milligrams per kilogram and 40 milligrams per kilogram every other week. Another study that was non-randomized and open-labeled for aglucosidase alpha in infantile onset Pompe disease treated 21 patients who were 3 to 43 months of age, had minimal GAA activity, had abnormal left ventricular mass index, and the total time of treatment was 168 weeks with a median of 120 weeks. They received aglucosidase alpha once every 2 weeks by IV. At the end of the study, 71% of the patients were alive, 44% were invasive ventilator free, 62% achieved new motor milestones, and 86% gained functional independence skills. In terms of risk of death and risk of invasive ventilation, there was a significant reduction in the risk of death as illustrated in the graph when compared with a historical untreated control. There's also a significant reduction in the risk of invasive ventilation when compared with an untreated historical control. In a randomized study of aglucosidase alpha in patients with late onset Pompe disease, patients were randomized to either placebo or aglucosidase alpha 20 milligrams per kilogram once every 2 weeks, and both were treated for 78 weeks. 90 patients who were 8 years and older and had late onset Pompe disease were treated. They were needed to be ambulatory and free of invasive ventilation. In terms of efficacy endpoints, there was a statistically significant improvement in change from baseline on the 6-minute walk test between the treated group and the placebo group. There was also a statistically significant improvement in the change in the forced vital capacity from baseline to 78 weeks between those who were treated with aglucosidase alpha versus those who received placebo, again demonstrating the improvement in outcomes for patients with late onset Pompe disease. Some of the adverse events that are associated with aglucosidase alpha include rash in about 18%, pyrexia in 15%, urticaria and flushing in 13%, hypertension in 10%, and then decreased oxygen saturation and cough and tachypnea and other respiratory symptoms in approximately 8%. Some patients can develop symptoms of anaphylaxis as well. And so it's important to keep this in mind during the infusion. These are often manageable with pausing the infusion, restarting with a reduction in infusion rate and treatment with medication. Throughout the work in Pompe disease, it became clear that nearly all Pompe patients develop antibodies to their recombinant protein and that their cross-reactive immune material or CRIM status was a determinant in their ability to develop antibodies to the recombinant protein. In particular, there's a cohort of patients who are determined to be CRIM negative, who have no cross-reactive immune material that's the pre-infusion. They are prone to developing high antibody titers to the recombinant enzyme, and these are associated with clinical decline despite ongoing therapy. In a retrospective study of the influence of CRIM status in outcomes of patients who are receiving alglucosidase alpha, all of the CRIM-negative patients were diseased or ventilated by 27 months. And so as a result of this observation of CRIM status and the development of antibodies to recombinant protein, several protocols have been introduced for induction of immune tolerance in patients who are CRIM-negative. We're going to switch gears now to some of the experimental approaches that have been designed to enhance the effect of recombinant enzymes. Effective delivery to lysosomes depends on the mannose-6-phosphate content of the recombinant enzyme. And this is because the enzyme is delivered to lysosomes by recognition of the mannose-6-phosphate tag on the enzyme by a mannose-6-phosphate receptor that is on the surface of lysosomes. The limited effect of the enzyme replacement therapy in skeletal muscle in patients who are affected with Pompe disease has been mainly attributed to both the low numbers of mannose-6-phosphate groups on the recombinant enzyme and also to the low expression of receptors on the cell surface of muscle cells. And so that is the approach taken for second generation enzyme replacement therapy that's in clinical trials for Pompe disease. The name of the second generation product is avaglucosidase alpha or NeoGAA. And so avaglucosidase alpha is a recombinant version of GAA that's conjugated with this mannose-6-phosphate residues, and that is designed to increase the cellular uptake at the target tissue. In preclinical studies, avaglucosidase alpha was demonstrated to be 5 times more effective than alglucosidase alpha at clearing glycogen from the heart, diaphragm, and skeletal muscle, and it's in development for infantile onset and late onset Pompe disease. In a phase 1/2 trial of avaglucosidase alpha and late-onset Pompe disease, 24 patients with late-onset Pompe disease were treated. 10 of the patients were treatment naive, and 14 of the patients had previously been treated with avaglucosidase alpha for at least 9 months. They were all adults. They could all walk at least 50 meters independently, and their upright forced vital capacity was at least 50% of predicted at baseline. They were treated for 24 weeks at 3 different dose levels, 5 milligrams, 10 milligrams per kilo, 20 milligrams per kilo, all once every 2 weeks delivered by intravenous infusion. And the study was completed by 9 patients who were naive and 12 patients who were treatment experienced. There were no deaths or life-threatening serious adverse events. There was 1 report in 1 patient of an infusion-related serious adverse event. 4 of the naive patients had 11 infusion-associated reactions, and 4 experienced patients had 14 infusion-associated reactions. Between the 3 dosage groups, the 6-minute walk test distances were increased with avaglucosidase alpha across the groups and dose levels. There were several functional scores, such as the QMFT and HHD scores, that were improved in the naive and experienced patients, irrespective of dose. One has to keep in mind, though, that this is primarily a safety study and a PK study, and with a limited number of patients, and so any efficacy endpoints will be exploratory. An extension study was continued after the initial phase 1, phase 2, and 19 of the 24 patients entered this extension study. All patients in the extension were switched to received 20 milligrams per kilogram of avaglucosidase alpha once every 2 weeks. And the participants who remain in the study will continue to receive the investigational product of glucosidase alpha for a planned follow-up of 6 years. Thus far, there has been no evidence of inhibition of enzyme activity in patients who have been dosed over 3.5 years. There are other ongoing trials of avaglucosidase alpha. COMET is a randomized phase 3 trial comparing avaglucosidase alpha with alglucosidase alpha in treatment-naive patients with late-onset Pompe disease. The planned recruitment is for 96 participants who are at least 3 years of age, and the primary endpoint is a change in the predicted percentage of forced vital capacity. There's also the mini-COMET clinical trial. This is a randomized, open-label phase 2 study of avaglucosidase alpha in treatment-naive pediatric patients who have infantile-onset Pompe disease. 20 participants will be enrolled. They will be under 3 years of age. Finally, a clinical trial utilizing two investigational products is available for Pompe disease. The investigational products are a recombinant enzyme replacement therapy called ATB-200. This recombinant enzyme has a high number of mannose-6-phosphate and bis-mannose-6-phosphate glycan content, and it's administered by IV. AT-2221 is an orally administered chaperone molecule that stabilizes ATB-200. There was a presentation for the initial phase 1, phase 2 study in adults with late-onset Pompe disease. There were 3 cohorts in the study. 2 of them had previously received enzyme replacement therapy and were switched to the novel recombinant enzyme ATB-200. 1 of the cohorts was naive to enzyme replacement therapy. In the initial stage, or stage 1 of the study, each cohort received a single ascending dose of ATB-200 of 5, 10, or 20 milligrams per kilogram. Then, after safety was assessed, participants in the stage 2 of the study were co-administered chaperone and the enzyme replacement therapy. And it was demonstrated that co-administration of the chaperone and the enzyme replacement therapy had an increase in the protein distribution half-life relative to administering ATB alone. There was also an increase in recombinant GAA protein and activity when co-administered when compared to the same time points using ATB-200 alone. The AEs were generally mild and transient. There were 3 infusion-associated reactions in the 400-plus infusions that took place at study analysis. And in terms of markers of muscle damage, CK, ALT, and AST, and substrate accumulation of the tetrasaccharide, these decreased in patients that received ATB-200 co-administered with AT-2221. Some additional efficacy parameters from this trial included an improvement in motor function tests, which were consistent and durable to month 9 in ambulatory patients in cohorts 1 and 3. There were also increases in upper extremity strength in the non-ambulatory patients, or cohort 2, at month 6. Forced vital capacity increased in the ERT-naive patients, so cohort 3, and was generally stable in the ambulatory patients who had switched ERT, so cohort 1. So some of the conclusions are that development and introduction of enzyme replacement therapy for Pompe disease has definitely changed the natural history of the condition, and particularly extended the lifespan of patients and improved morbidity. The results, however, had not fully met expectations, and many patients continue to experience a significant disease burden. However, the limitations of enzyme replacement therapy have stimulated efforts to enhance efficacy of the current treatment modalities and also to develop methods for earlier diagnosis of patients, i.e. newborn screening, with the hopes that an early diagnosis and an early initiation of treatment will improve outcomes, particularly before irreversible changes take place.
This activity has been jointly provided by Medical Learning Institute Incorporated and PVI, Peerview Institute for Medical Education. Thank you for listening. Download materials and complete the post-test for instant credit at www.peerview.com/DJF. This activity is supported by an educational grant from Sanofi Genzyme.